Good morning. Namaste. Very welcome, very warm welcome to all of you. Today we are going to discuss a very, very important issue of our times. It's about the needy people and their needs for wash in the urban context. In our urban areas, cities, whether these are metropolitans or small towns, you know, how the need of the vulnerable population has been met during COVID or even in the new normal where we are going to live with COVID situation for some time to come, how those needs are, you know, being met. And to discuss this, we have a very esteemed, set of panelists with us. We have Mr. G. Mathi Vathanan, who is Principal Secretary Urban Development of Odisha. We have Ms. Akhila Sivadas, Center for Advocacy and Research, New Delhi. We have with us Mr. Sandeep Khare, Vigyan Foundation, Lucknow. And Mr. Bejwara Wilson would be joining us very soon in half an hour from Safai Karamchari Andolan. And we have Ms. Manvita Barod from Urban Management Center, Ahmedabad. Before we, you know, initiate, I will just put 2 points here. Just to acknowledge, one is that, you know, we are witnessing a kind of reverse migration, hundreds and thousands of most needy people walking back to their states, villages, cities of, because cities of their work fell short of giving belongingness, warmth and kindness, which was required to keep them back in those cities. And the second thing which I would like all of us to acknowledge is that, you know, what we have realized is that hand washing, access to water, sanitation, how important and how critical it is. And as in the congested areas, in slums, in Dhari, we are hearing from West Bengal, from many other places, from the slums area, which are becoming hotspot of COVID-19. And it has shown us the whole limitation of our work in terms of reaching out to the most needy, you know, which is all inclusive and which is equitable. Jo sabke liye barabar ho, suvidhaen aur sabke liye ho. To isi baat ke saath hum log ye charcha shuru karte hain. I will first ask Mr. G. Mathi Vathanan, who is here with us, and all our panelists are, in a very nice space where they are the practitioners, they are implementing things on ground, as well as they are working at the policy space also. So we are expecting to hear very good, inspiring insights from each of you. And first we will start with Mr. Mathi Vathanan. In terms of, you know, in Odisha, I would, you know, it would be great to know that how the Odisha government has planned to ensure access to water, sanitation and hygiene in urban areas. And what has been your challenges, you know, while doing that? And if you think there are some learnings for other states to pick up, you know, so it would be great. Over to you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. I would like to give a brief background about what Odisha has been doing in the last few years, and then what currently we are doing during the COVID situation and what would be our challenges in the coming days. During the past few years, if you know, Odisha has given more thrust on improving the urban drinking water services to address the infrastructure gaps, poor service coverage, intermittent supply, high water losses, so that we can have easy and equitable access to all the categories of people in all the towns. Presently, we supply about 914 million liters every day, which roughly constitutes about 90% of our total demand, benefiting about 70 lakh population in the state. But there has been huge disparity within the city, within the ward areas, and between the cities also. Some areas were getting very high supply, some cities were getting very high supply, and some areas within the city were getting inadequately very, very low supply of water. And now the supply hours also varied great. So in 2015-16, we came up with a policy, urban water policy, to provide universal access to potable piped water supply on a 24/7 basis at an affordable, equitable, and sustainable manner to all areas in all the urban local bodies of the state. Universal coverage in the entire state. An ambitious program has been drawn up in all the 114 towns of the state in 2017 with an investment of about 3,600 crores with 763 projects. That time it was 20 times of the annual expenditure made on water supply. We were getting about 150 to 200 crores every year. We hiked up to 3,600 crore in a period of 2 to 3 years. At one time, we got the financial allocation. Our focus has been to increase the pipe networks rather than increasing the supply so that we can reach the deprived areas, uncovered areas, especially the slums and the marginal areas. And also to take the pipe inside the house to reach the last mile. Not only that, you cover only the street, but every household should get the water supply connection. That was our focus. That's the ultimate objective. Almost 80% of the new investments out of the 3,600 crores were channelized only to cover these two critical gaps. Increase the pipe network in the entire city area and take it to the household level. Give the household connection. So you'd be happy to know that out of that 763 projects, more than 700 projects have been completed in the meanwhile, in the past 2 years. Water supply distribution networks have increased by more than double. We were at the level of 5,400 kilometers. Now we are more than 11,400 kilometers network in the state. 49 towns were water deficient in 2016-17. Now all those water deficient towns, 49 towns, have turned to be water sufficient. We provide minimum 70 to 135 liters per capita per day. Household service connection, what we call as last mile connectivity, also has increased by more than 100%. We were somewhere around 3 lakh in 16. Now we have crossed 6 lakh connections. And we have an ultimate target of increasing this to 12 lakh so that we can have the universal coverage of pipe water supply reaching every household. We have also focused on the quality of water, not only the quantity, reach, availability, also on the quality. We have established 9 state-of-the-art water testing laboratories in the last 3 years on PPP mode across the state to monitor the quality of water supply. To go a step forward, the state also, as part of the reforms in the water sector, has established a government not-for-profit company called VATCO, Water Corporation of Odisha, called as VATCO, exclusively for the water and sanitation services. The objective mainly is to inculcate the corporate governance and efficiency in the water supply sector, to provide functional autonomy to the organization, to provide operational flexibility, and to have the customer-centric service culture in the water supply sector. So now, since the universal coverage is almost at the fag end, we are about to reach that, we are in the last leg, government has now decided to move into higher orbit. We have taken up a new mission called Drink From Tap Mission. Drink From Tap. It's called Drink From Tap Mission. The purpose in simple words is you should drink from the tap without any apprehension. The government should provide quality in such a manner that people should have confidence. They don't need to buy water bottle, water can, no need to construct overhead tanks, filters, boiling the water. You should have the confidence on the public water supply system and you should drink from the tap. So with that objective, state government has taken up this ambitious mission called Drink From Tap. The objectives are to provide 24/7 water supply along with 100% metering, water quality surveillance as well as assurance. That's our focus. And community partnership in the water supply management. Ultimately, the water supply at the grassroots level has to be managed in partnership with the community. So the currently the this mission, which has been taken up about 6 months ago, of course interrupted by the COVID now, has been put on hold due to this. We are implementing that in 7 pilot zones, 5 in Bhubaneswar city and 2 in Puri town. It covers about 1.2 lakh population, the pilot area itself, benefiting about 24,000 households. And in the meanwhile, we have completed 4 zones, benefiting about 8,000 households, 40,000 population in Bhubaneswar and Puri. As far as the strategy for the current COVID situation is concerned, I would like to mention here that providing uninterrupted water supply is highest priority for us as of now. During the current ongoing lockdown period, as most of the population is forced to remain inside the home, the domestic water demand has sharply increased beyond our expectations. And along with the increased requirement of frequent hand washing, sanitation practices, it has really caused a great challenge on the water supply authorities, organizations. The government considered operation and maintenance of the water supply and sanitation as most essential services during this COVID and have given highest priority. Our workforce has been continuously mobilized 24/7 to ensure uninterrupted services. In fact, if you visit our towns, you can take feedback. Nobody would know that the city is under lockdown as far as the water supply and sanitation are concerned. We'll find absolutely no difference in the service level. Rather, we have enhanced the service level, increased the number of hours of supply, increases the quantity of supply to the public so that they don't feel they don't get the pinch of that. In fact, during this period only, the water supply and sanitation services have been notified as essential services under the ESMA Act as a preparatory activity. We didn't want to, you know, face any eventuality. So in advance, we notified this both the services, water supply as well as sanitation, as an essential services so that we'll have the protection of ESMA Act. To provide 24/7 customer care, our centralized customer care is now converted to IVRS based with 24/7 automatic complaint login, automatic transfer of the complaint to the O&M staff, and online tracking of the redressals. We are also introducing the mobile van laboratories on wheels. It is not that you get complaint and then there is a time lag between complaint and redressal. So the moment you get a complaint, the mobile van having the laboratory will reach. We are working on that. We have also taken up a campaign called Pure for Sure, and we provide the real time water quality data available for the public. We have a digital display system in all the urban local bodies, where on daily basis we display the quantity of water supplied, quality of water, water parameters, number of hours of supply, all those things for the public domain. We have also, every year Odisha faces, almost every year we faces cyclone threat. Disasters are very common to us. So power backup is very, very critical, especially in the cyclone prone areas. So we have, over the period of time, we have enhanced our disaster preparedness, and almost all our water supply installations are provided with alternative power supply. So DG sets are provided. And it is not possible to cover even smaller water supply installation. So what we have done, we have now DG sets on wheels of varying capacity. Wherever we have disaster, wherever we have problems, we can wheel those DG sets quickly within few hours of time. And those DG sets are positioned in critical locations. And migrant workers is a current huge problem for us. The migrating migrant workers, Odisha has lots of migrant workers all over the country from abroad also. Many of the migrant workers are actually plumbers. Odisha is known for plumbers. There are few blocks and a district. The Kendrapada district and the Pattamundai block is known for providing plumbers all over the world, we can say. So many of them have now returned back. So we are actually exploring to enlist them, empanel them, and then use them as our technical personnel in our ongoing water supply maintenance works, as well as to provide household connection works. So community participation has been a very, very important component of our strategy. For community-centric water supply service, VATCO has rolled out a reform initiative called Jal Sathi. Members from the Women Self-Help Group, Odisha is actually very strong in Women Self-Help Group movement. It's called Mission Sakti. The members of this Mission Sakti, who are among the community, are appointed as Jal Sathis, and they work with us on incentive-based contract mechanism. So they are our partners at the grassroots level. This is a novel initiative we have taken up. And their role is to distribute the bills to the households, including meter reading. They collect the revenue from the households, facilitate complaint management, and they also carry out household level on-site water quality testing. This is a huge jump we have made. We are not only using as a sub-staff or unskilled laborers, we are also enhancing their skill level and using them as a technical personnel. So we have provided quality training and we are using them as our field quality personnels. So they undertake the quality testing. So they have been trained with the rigorous capacity building programs, and they are provided with a handheld MPOS machine, which they use for collecting the revenues from the households. They are also provided with the water testing kits and other accessories. Incentives are paid based on the activity, based on revenue collection, based on new connection made, based on the number of quality tests they have performed. Based on those things, incentives are paid to the self-help group members. This program has helped us now to build up the community linkage very strongly with the water supply authority. And also, it's an income-generating activity for the unemployed women self-help group members. We plan to have about 5,000 Jal Sathis all over the state in all the urban local bodies. Our ultimate target is that the entire revenue collection from the water sector, about 250 crores per annum, has to be collected through the women self-help groups, and through which they can earn about 10 crores every year as an incentive. So our experience so far with the community participation, women self-help group cooperation is extremely good, very encouraging. If we have to talk about water supply services to the urban poor, as I mentioned right from the beginning, our focus has been to cover the unreached people, deprived slums, uncovered areas. So in the urban water policy, we have envisioned right to water for everybody in the urban area. That's an underlying principle of our policy, right to water in the urban areas. So to provide 24/7, we have taken up, as I said, we have taken up 7 zones on pilot basis. You would be happy to know that 2 of those pilot zones are actually slums, out of which one is the largest slum in the state, which is called Saliasahi, where Akira Madam also is working in that Basti. It's called Saliasahi. It has about 60,000 population. So that is one of our pilot zone where program is implemented. And the first pilot zone already commissioned successfully is also another slum called Ishaneswar Basti in Bhuneshwar, where 100% households have 24/7 drink from tap water supply for the past almost 5 months. It's a successful program being run by us. And the policy also envisages, it's a radical policy which we envisaged in 2016, to provide 2 taps in each slum household at government cost. One in kitchen, another one is in the toilet. And the water supply connection is made free of charges. There are no upfront charges, with user charges made nominal, which is to be collected every month. So as far as the challenges during the COVID is concerned, accessibility to the field is a great challenge for us, especially during the lockdown with lots of hotspots and containment zone. Reaching, you know, the problematic area for maintenance staff has been an issue. Getting laborers in this difficult situation has been an issue. Dealing with the leakage management has been an issue to wherever we get complaint, because the supply hours have been increased, demand has gone up, we need to continuously supply the water, and the more you supply, the more leakage will happen. So leakage management has become a major issue for us. And since the economy is not doing well, there is an anticipated economic crunch in the coming days. So we have an apprehension that government's priority of funding may undergo change due to lesser revenue collection. Availability of funds may become a problem. So, but the thing is, the good thing is that we have always focused on convergence of funds from various sources. So now also we anticipate, we are preparing ourselves to get convergence from leverage other funds like mineral district funds available. And we also have KFW funded program called Odisha Urban Infrastructure Development Fund. So we have plans to source funding from different sources to keep our water supply sector agendas going on, like our 24/7 drink from tap. So broadly, these are the currently the focus areas of the state. Thank you, madam.
Thanks a lot. I think we heard a lot of great initiatives from Odisha in terms of right to water, the whole solution about piped network and reaching till the household level, this whole strategy of that. Also on the water quality front, drink from the tap. Also the information in the public domain. And we also heard some interventions from the slums area, the kind of models which has been worked. Perhaps we will hear more on those from Akhila when she will talk about some of the work which Akhila has done and linking it to that. In terms of challenges, I think it's very, this thing that, water is essential, sanitation and hygiene is important, but at the same time, the investment might drop in this sector. I think this is something which we all need to be very careful about and, be kind of advocating for that, because COVID has shown that how important it is. So while we are, prioritizing different sectors, how this sector gets that due investment. So not taking much time, we will again come back to Mr. Mathivanan in the end, and we will take some questions in the end from our, people who are on this webinar. But now I will ask our second speaker, Ms. Akhila. I'll ask Akhila to come on board now. And, Akhila, in terms of like the way Mr. Mathivanan has talked about lots of, government policies, initiatives, but I would like you, and he also talked about rights and, slums, but I would like you to specifically focus on the equity and the whole, inclusion bit, that lens, taking that lens for urban wash, what do you think, what could be the mechanism? How do we bring that? And the second is, also, what role, we have seen what role government can play, and also at the local level, the capacity building of masons and, so much and so far, but at the same time, what role can be played by the community-based organization, at the local governance level. So basically on these two, over to you, Akhila. Thanks.
Thank you, Anita, and thank you, Raman, for, giving us this opportunity. And of course, a big hello to all the co-panelists and people who are part, you have joined the webinar. I want firstly to, at the outset, to commend what, Mr. Mathivanan has presented. It really is walking the talk. And we are all privy to what is happening. And he never fails to be part of the community process. Even at 7 in the morning, is out there with us. So notwithstanding that, I'd like to preface my presentation with two, sort of cautionary remarks, Vanita. One is that this is not about us and them. A lot of this, the kind of points that civil society makes, it's not about just pointing fingers or blaming anybody or creating, criticizing for the sake of criticizing. We're all really in a difficult predicament today, and we stand to lose a lot of what we have gained over the years in the months to come. The challenge is enormous. And what we are witnessing today, the migrant workers, is something that has been steadily growing and simmering since the 70s. This has not happened overnight, you know. It's not something that has just suddenly exploded. It's been simmering. And it's reflected in the wider insecurity and the wider indignity that the urban poor has been facing. But there was a time in early 2000 when they were virtually disenfranchised. They were getting no rights. They were running from pillar to post. They were being told everywhere that you're gair kanuni, that you're illegal, your existence cannot be recognized. You know, and it is at this time when civil society networks, movements, and particularly state and city governments, I'm not putting them out of the radar at all, they played a huge role. They all realized that the situation is untenable. And it was in the mid-2000 that suddenly people woke up to the huge, you know, shall we say, crisis in the country. And that, you know, it's not about just rural poverty, there is something called urban poor. And the first time in the 11th five-year plan, you got actually an acknowledgement of that, that, you know, there is something called urban poverty and something called urban poor. And not many years have gone by. You know, in the history of a nation, what is 10 years? And we are faced with this crippling crisis called COVID-19. And so what were we facing at that time? Which is what I would like to highlight. And this includes your basic services and WASH services. A combination of what you call administrative process, very difficult to fulfill, very difficult to comply in terms of schemes, services, and social entitlements, and local dynamics with very little decentralization happening, you know, and shall we say power brokers and local, you know, power leaders or power structures taking over, and even often paralyzing the formal structures and forcing them to capitulate to what they want. So you do have that kind of situation in large pockets of the country. There's no getting away from it. And it is in this context, you know, that the urban poor were being squeezed. They were not being even allowed to do what they could do. If you are a sex worker, you were hunted by the police. If you are a street vendor, you were thrown out of the lanes that you're not supposed to, you're not licensed to be in. So it was all very, very ugly. You know, the situation was very, very grim. It's in this scenario, the response of many of us who stand by the rights of the workers, it's important to talk about. And it is in that context that Mr. Mathivadanan's presentation becomes so significant. You know, we did not just rest on a problem. We went about trying to solve it and address it. And in the urban context, it's much more difficult. Lived cities, and there are sort of, you know, there are what are called locked-in processes in the system. You're like, you're landlocked, your system is locked. You can't budge, you can't move, you can't converge. Even if you converge over a meeting, it doesn't converge the heart or whatever you're intending to converge. So the first thing we had to do, and the government did it in its own way and we did it in our own way, was to contend with those informal structures at the local level. We had to strongly contend with them. We had to collectivize, not just about expressing needs, just as Mr. Mathivadanan was saying about, you know, reading the meters, meeting the bills, collecting the dues, all of that, going beyond just expressing needs and demands, actually aggregating the demands so that we don't get into one size fits all. Everybody has a special need. And here I would like to profess and, you know, join with Mr. Mathivadanan saying that it's not just about the poor. Within the poor, there are ranges of, you know, what are called hidden communities. Communities that have never been mainstream, that are struggling to make ends meet. And there are innumerable of them, you know. So this entire collectivization had to be strengthened with skills, ability, capacity to forge consensus, gather evidence, give feedback, set right the grievance redress, all of that. On the other end, there has to be equal vigor. You know, and there should be very close collaboration with civil society. We have nothing, no other intention except to help the entire process to move forward. The second thing we did, you know, apart from collectivization, and this is a shall we say, a coterminous thing, that is, engage with the system day after day. It doesn't matter if they don't respond. Doesn't matter if they don't listen. Doesn't matter if you don't get a reply. They rarely reply. They do their work, but they don't necessarily reply. It's important to do it every day. Why? Because you need to sensitize them. They often don't take decisions because they do not know things. You know, it's quite amazing. Despite them being on the ground, many things they do not see and they do not know. So to help them also to take decisions, they're as fragile as any of us are, because they're often lonely in their jobs, often get very little support. The system is never a collaborative system. It's highly competitive systems. So nobody really helps each other. You know, they try and maintain the civility of help. It doesn't go too far always. So our role in sensitizing the system becomes very, very critical. And this is where, in the context of COVID, Mr. Mathivadanan said, you know, we are locked down. How do we link? How do we meet communities? How do we reach out to them? How do we create that kind of what we call a meaningful connect? A connect that, you know, actually impacts people's lives. You can actually see something hitting the ground. And that's where, yes, also about hand washing, in the context of wash, definitely hand washing. The entire sanitation value chain. Everything is, you know, making people nervous. If waste is piling, they're getting nervous. If, you know, bits are not being de-sludged, they're getting frightened. So entire, you know, value chain. And this is where now we really have to understand community empowerment. We really must decentralize. And we must understand that however much you do from the top, however much you enable from the top, however much you, you know, create these conditions, things have to be seized at the bottom. Things have to be, you know, shall we say, nurtured and taken to scale from at the bottom. So this is really very critical in COVID context. And to do both, what has really stood us, you know, we have been able to, with the community platforms across 14 cities, we have been able to zoom in relief. One, of course, is food relief, but there's also what is called the dignity kit, hygiene kit, many things people need. Where is the soap? Where is the detergent? Where is the sanitary napkin? Where is all the stuff that you're expected to use to be able to stay healthy and prevent the virus? So the community platforms have just zoomed in. We are working with over 25 relief agencies in the remotest part of the cities in the country, reaching out to the most hidden groups, right from people living with HIV, transgender, sex workers, denotified tribes, to people living in patient sites, just about you can name anything, we are there. And the entire credit goes to the community platforms. And in Bhubaneswar, we were told by the men, Mr. Mathivadanan, that they have decided that the men cannot handle COVID. They ask the men now to stay at home, take care of the home. Because if they go to the market, they don't maintain social distance. They are not disciplined in fighting the thing. So they've taken over the mantle of marketing and all that you are talking about so that, you know, the communities are safe. They've also taken over the mantle, Mr. Mathivadanan, of looking after the healthcare workers. The paramedics are living in the slums. And before any stigma starts and any discrimination and intolerance begins, they have, you know, what is called a security net around them and to support them. So they are, you know, the kind of resilience and the kind of quick thinking and the kind of, you know, seva and service they can do is unimaginable. And all that, if it is not tapped today, and we don't break the silo of government, non-government, communities, civil, all of that, you know, think tank, all of that, if we don't break those silos and build on the robust common sense and resilience of the community, we have much to lose. So the two mechanisms that I'm recommending here are what we call management committees. You know, self-help groups are wonderful. They federate, they come together, they build a collective ethos. They may not necessarily rise to the kind of, you know, demands that WASH makes. WASH makes demands every minute. WASH creates shortages and crisis every minute. And Bosch can, if Bosch is not properly sort of, you know, harnessed, then the pandemic cannot be contained. That's a given fact. The triangulation of health, nutrition, and sanitation has never happened in this concentrated manner as today under COVID. So it's a huge opportunity to form management committees at the slum, designated across each lane block, and being able to handle many of the complex, you know, processes on the ground, at the ward level, to have what is called a single window mechanism that aggregates, ascertains, and ensures that everybody gets their due from the system, and the system gets all the information about the people so that they can take informed decision. The kind of mechanism we need is absolutely essential. And of course, investing in persons with disability, transgender, elderly, adolescents, single women, all the sort of marginal groups has to be put right on top. We cannot have what is called a big tent called the urban poor, you know, right now, life-impairing challenges that they are facing. Thank you.
Thanks, Akhila. Yes. So I think these insights we were looking forward to in terms of the whole, you know, urban poor and the desegregation of those categories as such, and the needs would be very different. And then the governance at the very local level, either through self-help groups or the management committees, and how that process itself helps in the overall governance of, you know, the government and otherwise at the community level. So and it's also great to see that the kind of collaboration which is there with the civil society and at the government level in Odisha. And we just hope, I think these are also some of the lessons for other states as well. So with this, thanks, Akhila, and we will again come back to you later. And now I will ask Sandeep Khare, who is from Vigyan Foundation, Lucknow. Sandeep ji, aap bhi kaafi kaam kar rahe hain, kaafi saare, aur kaafi saalon se kaam kar rahe hain, Uttar Pradesh mein, Lucknow mein especially, slums areas mein, aur kaafi saare informal labor ke saath, migrant labor ke saath, aur bahut saare groups ke saath. To aise samay mein, जो कोविड का समय है, आपको क्या लगता है कि किस तरह के चैलेंजेस जो है पानी या स्वच्छता को लेके जो अभी उभर कर आए हैं और जिन पर नजर जानी बहुत जरूरी है, और आपका अपना क्या अनुभव रहा है इस पूरे इस सिलसिले में, आपका अपना अनुभव क्या कहता है, हम लोग सुनना चाहेंगे आपसे. थैंक्स एंड अनम्यूट संदीप.
शुक्रिया रमन जी और वाटर एड के सभी साथियों को कि उन्होंने हमें अपनी बात रखने का मौका दिया. और जहां तक विज्ञान फाउंडेशन के नाते, और मैं स्वयं जितना शहरी गरीबों के साथ और असंगठित क्षेत्र के जो मजदूर साथी हैं उनके साथ जो काम करता रहा हूं, उसका जो अनुभव है वो मैं शायद आपके साथ बांट पाऊँ. और COVID-19 के परिप्रेक्ष्य में अगर हम देखें और लॉकडाउन के परिप्रेक्ष्य में देखें, तो हम देखते हैं कि ये पहली बार है जब शहरों के अंदर जो अदृश्य शहर बसे थे, जो हमको दिखते नहीं थे, वो सड़कों पर चलते फिरते रूप में, जिंदा रूप में हमारे सामने आ गए हैं. और पूरे 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 देश में सभी लोगों का ध्यान इस ओर है. तो ये जहां एक और संकट का समय है कि इतने बड़े पैमाने पर पलायन आजादी के बाद हो रहा है, वहीं हमारे लिए अवसर भी है कि हम जो सेवाएं हैं उन सेवाओं के संदर्भ में अपने आप को नए सिरे से देख पाए. हमारे पास जो विकास के जो तरीके हैं, जो मॉडल हैं, उनके बारे में नए तरीके से सोच पाए. क्योंकि अगर हम देखते हैं तो हर शहर, जहाँ पे मैं खुद लखनऊ में रहता हूँ और बाकी दूसरे शहर जो भारत में है, उनके विकास को अगर देखें तो बहुत सेंट्रलाइज डेवलपमेंट है. मतलब अगर लखनऊ देखें या दिल्ली देखें या फरीदाबाद देखें, हम कलकत्ता देखें, चेन्नई देखें, तो उनके आसपास के शहर एक मुर्दा शहरों की तरह हैं, वो जिंदा शहर नहीं है. और सारे लाइवलीहुड के जो साधन हैं, जो जो बाकी रिसोर्सेस हैं, वो एक खास करके एक जगह पे हैं और इसको हम देखते हैं आइडियाज जर्नलिज्म JNNURM जो आया और उसमें जो सेवाओं के लिए फिर 63 सिटीज आए, फिर स्मार्ट सिटी में 100 सिटीज आए और जहां पे सेवाओं को बहुत संगठित तौर पे विकसित करने की बात हुई मगर उसके आसपास की सेवाओं के ऊपर बहुत ज्यादा ध्यान बहुत ज्यादा बातचीत नहीं की गई। तो ये हम लोग को दिख पा रहा है कि पहली बार ये हो रहा है कि जब हमारे सामने एक मौका है कि हम अपने पूरे विकास के मॉडल को ना सिर्फ वास के टर्म में बल्कि दूसरे तरह सेवाओं के मुद्दे के आधार पर भी सोचें विचार करें कि हम अल्टीमेटली किस तरह की सेवाएं देना चाहते हैं। दूसरा मुझे जो कहना है कि ये बातचीत हमको इस आधार से भी देखनी चाहिए कि ये जो पानी और सफाई और साफ सफाई का जो मुद्दा है जब लॉकडाउन हुआ और लॉकडाउन के दौरान जिस तरीके की क्राइसिस पैदा हुई उसमें पानी के ऊपर खर्चे बढ़े और पानी का जो खर्चा बढ़ा उसका सबसे बड़ा प्रभाव अगर हम महिलाओं के संदर्भ में देखें तो उन पे ज़्यादा ये प्रभाव पड़ा क्योंकि हम जिन लोगों के साथ काम करते हैं खासकर बस्तियों में वहाँ पे पानी एकत्रित करने का काम ज़्यादातर महिला साथी करती हैं तो ये एक्सपेंडिचर जो पानी पे अचानक बढ़ा उसकी वजह से महिला साथियों के ऊपर काम का बोझ भी पड़ा और उस काम के बोझ को पानी और पानी के ऊपर जो उनका बोझा पड़ा वो हिंसा से भी जुड़ा हुआ मुद्दा है। तो हम इसको इस तरह से भी देखें कि जो पूरा पानी का सवाल है और पानी के सवाल बस्तियों में जो हमने देख पा रहे हैं कि पानी की बढ़त की वजह से और उनके पानी उतना फ्रिक्वेंटली वो एक्सेस नहीं कर सकते थे तो कई कई जगह पे हिंसा के तौर पे भी हम इसको देखते हैं। तो इस सवाल पे भी हमको आने वाले दिनों में समझना होगा कि पानी का जो रिश्ता गरीबी और गरीबी के साथ वो हिंसा से जो जुड़ा हुआ रिश्ता है उसको कैसे हम आने वाले दिनों में अपनी प्लानिंग में देख पाएंगे। दूसरा एक बातचीत जो और समझ में आती है कि ये हमारे सामने एक ये भी मौका है कि हम नए सिरे से नागरिकों के अधिकारों के बारे में भी सोचें क्योंकि जब हमने अपने पूरे विकास के मॉडल को डिजाइन किया और हमने बड़े बड़े हाईवेज बनाए बड़े बड़े जगहों को बनाया और हब्स बनाए अलग अलग तो इतने सारे जो लाखों लाख प्रवासी मजदूर हाईवेज पे चल रहे हैं सड़कों पर चल रहे हैं बिना किसी उसके तो कहीं पे भी उनको पानी की सुविधाएं नहीं है सैनिटेशन फैसिलिटीज उनको एक्सेस नहीं है और देखने में सुनने में लाखों करोड़ों रुपए लगे लेकिन शायद आज वो पानी और शौचालय के बगैर वो हाईवेज है पानी और शौचालय के बगैर वो एरिया से जिनको हम बहुत अच्छे एरिया मानते थे। तो हमको अपनी जो भविष्य की जो भी हम योजनाएं बनाना चाहते हैं उसमें हमको देखना होगा कि क्या कुछ ऐसे मॉडल हम डिजाइन कर सकते हैं जो ज्यादा ऊर्जा ना लें और क्योंकि जितना ही ऊर्जा आधारित मॉडल हम ढूंढने की कोशिश करेंगे उसका बर्डन अल्टीमेटली समुदाय के ऊपर होगा और वो बर्डन आने वाले जो COVID-19 के बाद का जो दौर होने वाला है उसमें शायद जनता इतना बर्डन सहन करने की स्थिति में भी नहीं होगी। तो हमको हमारे सामने ये एक मौका है कि हम इसको देखें कि कैसे कम ऊर्जा आधारित मॉडल खास करके वास के संदर्भ में ढूंढे जा सकते हैं और जो हमने जो एक सेंट्रलाइज डेवलपमेंट के जो मॉडल हमारे सामने हैं क्योंकि डिसेंट्रलाइजेशन की हम बात तो कर रहे हैं लेकिन डिसेंट्रलाइजेशन डेवलपमेंट के मॉडल नहीं है तो वो उसके बारे में सोचें। दूसरा एक बात जहां मैं सबका ध्यान इंगित करना चाहूँगा कि अगर हम देखें तो अभी भी जो अदृश्य शहरों में जो अदृश्य शहर हैं उनमें भी बड़े पैमाने पर हमारे पास कोई रिपोर्टिंग नहीं है और इसीलिए जब लॉकडाउन शुरू हुआ तो किसी को ना तो सरकारों को ही अंदाजा था ना सिविल सोसाइटी को ही अंदाजा था और ना ही किसी व्यक्ति को अंदाजा था कि इतने सारे लोग सड़कों से निकलकर घरों की ओर चल पड़ेंगे। तो ये एक अच्छा मौका है जब हम मैप कर पाएं मैपिंग कर पाएं अर्बन पुअर्स की ऑक्यूपेशनल मैपिंग कर पाएं कि किस तरह के लोग किन इलाकों में हैं जैसे कि कहाँ जा रहे हैं किस तरह से रह रहे हैं और फिर क्या उनको हम थोड़ा ऑर्गेनाइज में थोड़ा फैसिलिटेट कर सकते हैं। तो ये एक बड़ा मौका है संकट को हम मौके की तरह अगर देखें तो शायद ये पहली बार है जब हम सब एक तरीके से पलायन और पलायन के सवालों पर बात कर रहे हैं और ये देख पा रहे हैं कि कुछ राज्य ऐसे हैं जैसे छत्तीसगढ़ बिहार झारखंड उत्तर प्रदेश जहाँ से इतने बड़े पैमाने पर पलायन हो रहा है और उन और ना सिर्फ पलायन हो रहा बल्कि कई जगहों पे तो कल्पना के विपरीत है कि क्या इन जगहों के साथी भी यहाँ से आएंगे। जैसे मैं एक एग्जांपल के तौर पे बताऊँ कश्मीर के साथी बाराबंकी एक जिला है जहाँ पे आलू की फैक्ट्री में काम करने के लिए आए हुए थे लॉकडाउन के दौरान जो शायद कल्पना नहीं है हमारी। तो ये एक बड़ा मौका है जब हम वास के संदर्भ में देखें कि इतने सारे लोग जो एक दूसरे शहरों में जाते हैं काम के तलाश में रहते हैं उनके लिए हम किस तरीके से वास की सर्विसेज विकसित करी जाए और कैसे वो लोगों के पक्ष में हो। दूसरा एक ध्यान मैं इसको भी दिलाना चाहूंगा, क्योंकि अभी भी जो सैनिटरी वर्कर्स है जिनको हम जिनके ऊपर पूरा जिम्मेदारी पूरे लॉकडाउन के दौरान है और लॉकडाउन के बाद भी शायद उनके ऊपर वो जिम्मेदारी होगी, क्योंकि COVID-19 ने एक बात तो सिखाई है कि हमारी आने वाली दुनिया बदल जाएगी, आगे की दुनिया। तो अभी जो आबादी के हिसाब से जो उनके ऊपर जो सफाई कर्मचारियों के ऊपर जो बोझ है वो लगातार उनका बढ़ रहा है। अगर हम देखें तो हमारे यहाँ पे लखनऊ में जितने भी सफाई कर्मचारी लगभग 6,932 के आसपास सफाई कर्मचारी हैं और उनका वर्कलोड इस लेवल पे है कि वो सुबह 6 बजे से लेके और पहले उनके ड्यूटी आवर 2 बजे तक खत्म हो जाते थे, अभी वो बहुत समय तक चलते हैं। और दूसरा उनका सैनिटाइज करने के अंदर भी जिम्मेदारी, तो वर्कलोड बहुत बढ़ा हुआ है। तो हमको इस और भी बातचीत करनी चाहिए कि जो सैनिटरी वर्कर्स हैं वो प्रॉपर इक्विप्ड कैसे रहें, कैसे वो खुद सेफ होकर दूसरों के जीवन में आए और उनका जो एक प्रॉपर एक स्टैंडर्ड है कि इतने पॉपुलेशन में इतना सैनिटरी वर्कर होना चाहिए, उसको कम से कम फॉलो करना की जरूरत है। तो एक ये बड़ा हम लोगों के सोचने का विषय है। एक और जगह है जहाँ पे हमको समझने की जरूरत है, और माननीय प्रधानमंत्री जी जिस तरीके से उन्होंने कहा कि आत्मनिर्भर भारत की ओर हम लोगों को बढ़ना चाहिए, तो ये आत्मनिर्भरता न सिर्फ भारत में बल्कि दुनिया के लोगों को भी शायद इसने COVID-19 ने सिखाया है कि हमको सेवाओं के सार्वजनिकरण की ओर बढ़ना चाहिए। क्योंकि जहां जहां भी आप स्वास्थ्य के अंदर देखें, वाट सर्विसेस में भी देखें, तो जहां जहां सेवाओं का ज्यादा निजीकरण हुआ था वहां सेवाएं बहुत खराब स्थिति में आई हैं, उनकी दशा बहुत खराब हुई है। तो ये शायद एक मौका है कि हम खास करके मूलभूत सुविधाएं जो है, पानी की सुविधा जो है, सैनिटेशन फैसिलिटीज जो है, स्वास्थ्य सेवाएं जो है, उनके ऊपर दोबारा से विचार करें और उनको सरकार खुद से जिम्मेदारी लेकर लोगों तक पहुंचाए। क्योंकि हमारा जो अनुभव है वो ये कहता है कि खास करके लॉकडाउन के दौरान या लॉकडाउन के बाद भी शायद जो निजीकरण हुआ है सेवाओं का वो लोगों के हितों में काम नहीं कर पा रही है, या शायद उनके संसाधन बहुत लिमिटेड होंगे मालूम नहीं। तो जो लोग काम कर रहे हैं वो सिर्फ और सिर्फ सरकार और सरकार के जो तहत काम करने वाले लोग हैं, और उनमें से कुछ साथी जो उनके साथ कोलैबोरेट कर पा रहे होंगे। तो ये एक मौका है कि हम अपनी सेवाओं को ज्यादा आत्मनिर्भर बनाएं, ज्यादा ज्यादा लोगों के हितों में काम कर सकें, इस लायक बनाएं। तो इसलिए हमको दोबारा नए सिरे से अपने सिटीजन चार्टर्स को डिफाइन करने की जरूरत होगी। हमको ज्यादा नए सिरे से जो सर्विसेज दी जा रही हैं उनकी SOP फिर से, जैसे पानी के संदर्भ में जो पानी लोगों को मुहैया कराया जाता है उसके संदर्भ में, या जो कम्युनिटी टॉयलेट या पब्लिक टॉयलेट हैं उनके संदर्भ में नए सिरे से अपनी प्लान ऑफ एक्शन डिजाइन करने की जरूरत है। क्योंकि हमने ये भी देखा कि अपने लखनऊ की कुछ बस्तियों में कि सामुदायिक शौचालयों के इस्तेमाल के लिए लोगों के ऊपर कर्ज का बोझा बढ़ा, क्योंकि वो फ्री नहीं हुए। तो उस दौरान जिन लोगों ने कम्युनिटी टॉयलेट इस्तेमाल किए तो वहां पे उन्होंने उधारी की कि भाई मैं अभी इसे इस्तेमाल करने दीजिए और जब बाद में पैसे होंगे तो हम आपको पैसे दे पाएंगे। या कुछ जगहों पे जो हम लोगों को बातचीत से पता चला कि लोगों ने अनाज के बदले, जैसे उन्होंने उनको जो अनाज मिल रहा था डोनेट कर रहे थे, उसमें से कुछ अनाज वो कम्युनिटी टॉयलेट में डोनेट करके टॉयलेट फैसिलिटी इस्तेमाल कर रहे थे। तो हमको ये सोचना होगा कि जब हम उनको पब्लिक सर्विसेज कहते हैं और बहुत सारा ओपन डेफिकेशन जो फ्री जोन बना वो कम्युनिटी टॉयलेट के बेसिस पे बना, क्योंकि स्लम्स के आसपास कम्युनिटी टॉयलेट बनाए गए और उनको कहा गया कि ये ओपन डेफिकेशन एरिया है, तो और वहाँ पे लोग इस सर्विस को अवेल करने के लिए अगर कर्ज या इस तरह की परिस्थिति में जाते हैं तो हमको अपने पूरे प्लान के बारे में सोचना चाहिए और वो लोगों के जो एक्सपेंडिचर्स है उसको कैसे रिड्यूस कर सकता है उसके बारे में बात करनी चाहिए। एक और छोटी सी बात से मैं रख के अपनी बात समाप्त करूंगा कि आने वाले दिनों में एक चीज वो ये है कि पानी के पूरे मुद्दे को, पानी एक बड़े संकट के तौर पे हम लोग के सामने है, बस्तियों के अंदर है। तो क्योंकि जो आंकड़े बताते हैं उन आंकड़ों के हिसाब से हर शहर में 20-22% स्लम की आबादी है, बाकी लोग आंकड़ों में है नहीं, और जो होमलेस कम्युनिटी है वो भी आंकड़ों में नहीं रहती है। अगर हम अध्ययन के हिसाब से देखें तो उत्तर प्रदेश के अंदर अराउंड 28,000 से 30,000 होमलेस है, जबकि जो सिविल सोसाइटी का जो आंकड़ा है उसके हिसाब से 19,000 लोग सिर्फ लखनऊ में रहते हैं। तो ये जो होमलेस का आंकड़ा है वो है रिक्शा चालक जो लोग हैं जो रिक्शों पर ही अपना जीवन बिताते हैं सोते हैं इन सब और JNURM में या स्मार्ट सिटी में हम लोगों ने पब्लिक टेस्ट ज्यादातर जगहों से हटाए इस नाते कि उसका वेस्टेज हो रहा है तो आने वाले दिनों में ये संकट और गहराने वाला है तो क्या हम लोग इस दिशा में सोच सकते हैं कि पानी की सार्वजनिक सेवाएं शुरू की जाए तो पब्लिक टैब जैसे पहले आज से 2005 के पहले जो पब्लिक टैब बहुत जगहों पे दिखाई देते थे क्या उनको फिर से हम देखें और इसको हैंड वॉशिंग यूनिट के तौर पे भी देखें कि पब्लिक प्लेसेस पे खास करके जो लेबर चौक्स हैं सब्जी मंडीज हैं या ऐसे जो प्लेस हैं जहाँ पे इनफॉर्मल सेक्टर के साथी लोग बहुत खड़े होते हैं चाहे वो जूता पॉलिश करने वाले हों या लोडिंग अपलोडिंग करने वाले लोग हों और खास करके उन जगहों पे जहाँ पे महिला साथी महिला जो वर्कर्स है वो ज़्यादा आती हैं तो उन जगहों पे क्या हम पानी पीने की व्यवस्थाएं हैंड वॉशिंग यूनिट्स इन सब सुविधाओं को बढ़ा सकते हैं देख सकते हैं और क्योंकि अगर ये काम ये हम नहीं कर पाएंगे तो शायद जो अभी COVID-19 के दौर में जो हमने सीखा है वो हमारे इनफॉर्मल सेक्टर या जो स्लम डवेलर्स हैं या अर्बन पुअर्स हैं उनको वो बेनिफिट नहीं दे पाएगा या उनको लाभ नहीं दे पाएगा और उसकी वजह से जो उनका जो एक्सपेंडिचर है वो उनके ऊपर बढ़ेगा तो मुझे लगता है कि इन खास करके लखनऊ में जो हमारा काम का अनुभव उत्तर प्रदेश में जो अलग अलग जगह से शहरी गरीबों के साथ जो काम का अनुभव रहा है उसका उससे हमने यही सीखा है। एक और चीज कि हमको नए सिरे से इस बात के ऊपर भी सोचना चाहिए कि क्या हम स्लम्स के अंदर जैसे हम लोग कह रहे हैं कि फूड अलाउंसेस जाने हैं फूड अलाउंसेस दिए जाए तो क्या ऐसी जो कम्युनिटीज हैं जहाँ पे अभी भी पानी की सेवाएं नहीं पूरी तरीके से हैं और बहुत सारे ऐसी जगह हैं तो क्या वाटर अलाउंस टाइप का कुछ आइडिया शुरू किया जा सकता है कि जहाँ पे वाटर अलाउंसेस दिए जाए उन लोगों को खास करके जो जो आज की तारीख में क्योंकि बहुत सारी बस्तियों में प्राइवेट लोग पानी को बेचते हैं और वो एक्सपेंडिचर उनका बहुत बढ़ा हुआ है तो वाटर अलाउंसेस जैसी अवधारणा पे बातचीत सरकार कर सकती है या कुछ और नया तरीके से सोच सकती है क्या तो मुझे लगता है ये बहुत सही समय है जब हम अपने पूरे डेवलपमेंट मॉडल को सही तरीके से सोचें और उन लोगों के बारे में सोचें जो आज तक हमको दिखते नहीं थे लेकिन COVID-19 के कारण सड़कों पर चल रहे हैं और समस्याओं से जूझ रहे हैं और इस समय तत्कालिक तौर पर भी अगर एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन जो प्रशासन है वो पूरे रास्ते में जहाँ से लोग आ रहे हैं वहाँ पे पानी और शौचालय की टेम्परेरी व्यवस्थाएं भी अगर विकसित कर सकते हैं लगा सकते हैं क्योंकि ये लॉकडाउन शायद अभी 17 के बाद भी बढ़ने वाला है और लोगों का जो पलायन है ये रुकने वाला नहीं है इतनी जल्दी से तो अगर वो सेवाएं वहाँ पे जो हाईवेज हैं उन जगहों पर हो सकती हैं तो शायद ये बहुत बेहतर होगा मेरे दृष्टिकोण से और भविष्य का रास्ता भी शायद यहीं से जाएगा जब अपनी वास्ट सर्विसेज का जो गैप है खास करके अर्बन पुअर्स के बीच में इनफॉर्मल सेक्टर के बीच में उसको रीडिजाइन कर पाए रीथिंक कर पाए और उनके पूरे राइट्स के बारे में रीथिंक कर पाए। धन्यवाद
संदीप जी आपका बहुत उस तरह के मुद्दे जैसे कि आपने बोला कि हाईवेज पे पानी की सुविधा नहीं है जहाँ पे लोग चल रहे हैं सिमिलरली पब्लिक टैप्स की सुविधा क्या फिर से वापिस आ सकती है उस पर ध्यान दिया जा सकता है साथ ही साथ सैनिटेशन वर्कर का जो मुद्दा है मेरे ख्याल से सभी जगहों पे आ रहा है इट्स द इशू ऑफ सैनिटेशन वर्कर्स इज आई थिंक इट्स अपेरेंट इन ऑल द स्टेट्स द काइंड ऑफ वर्क विच दे हैव टू डू दे हैव टू बी आउट ऑन द स्ट्रीट वेदर दे हैव प्रोटेक्टिव वेदर देयर वर्किंग आवर्स आर मोर देन रिक्वायर्ड एंड विच इज एन एसेंशियल ड्यूटी सो एंड व्हेन दिस इज ऑल्सो पार्ट ऑफ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट पार्ट ऑफ द सैनिटेशन चेन एज सच and also, you know, the issues of gender, which you raised about women, the whole responsibility which comes on that. I think very interesting ideas. And now I will take this discussion further because, you know, some of these ideas have to be at a very urban local bodies level, how the urban local bodies are responding to some of these requirements, some of these contextual mm-hmm. needs. So I would ask now Ms. Manvita Barot to come and, you know, Sanjeev, to talk about what are the lessons, you feel that what are the lessons from the measures taken by the urban local bodies in tackling wash situations in COVID situation and how can development partners and technical agencies support urban local bodies for all this, you know, all the suggestions which we have been hearing. Over to Manvita.
Sorry, I'll, yeah, I forgot to unmute. Thank you, Vanita and Ramanji and all my colleagues on the panel. It's been a pleasure to talk to all of you. The issues are very grim. And Mr. Mati and Akhilaji and Sandeepji very clearly pointed out what issues we are facing, especially in COVID times, and what opportunities it is now throwing at us. Urban local bodies are at the helm of things. They are the closest government, which is closest to the people. We have three tiers of government: the central, the state, and the local bodies. The local body is a government which is closest to us, and we should have known how many urban poor are there, what are the percentages of distressed people. They are invisible, fine, but well, it could have been possible for our cities to know. Sandeep ji, aap kuch keh rahe hain? Sorry. Hello. Okay. So, we could have had a situation where probably we knew how many urban poor are there, how many distressed communities are there, and where are the invisible people living. Mostly they live in urban slums, which are the neglected areas. Though, as we all know, the 74th Amendment to the Constitution in 1992-93 suggests that city governments' role is to work with the urban poor, empower them, and it is inclusive cities which is mandated by the Constitution. Cities have done some work since then. I wouldn't negate what has not been happening until now, but a comprehensive understanding and kind of blending them into the fabric, which has not happened. There are schemes, and if you look at our acts and schemes, they're amazing. There is a possibility to have a society which is, we all dream of, more inclusive, equitable, and just. However, why are we where we are? What is it that we are missing out? Maybe the convergence point between various government departments, I'm sure all of us, including the parts of the government, believe in what we all believe in. The civil society and the governments are mostly on the same page. They want to deliver. It is because we believe in welfare. However, it has not been done. The greatest blame I would put, or the greatest culprit, is probably the intersection of that, or to be able to work cohesively between civil society, the government, and the communities. The intersection has to come out very strongly. We have to work together to achieve something. Attempts are being made, but COVID situation threw this challenge in front of us, and it's out and open. Earlier, we were talking in our groups, networks. No, now it's people, everybody knows what's happening. What can be done? It is high time that we look and relook at our cities and the way we integrate the functions. The basic services have to be provided. So some examples. For instance, in Ahmedabad, in 1996 onwards, we had a slum networking program under which they decided very important thing is de-link the land tenure with basic services. You provide water and sanitation, and people will construct their own houses on their own, and they will invest in the formal house so that it's a better cleaner environment to live in. Why have we thrown this out of our window? Why is it not replicated all over the country? I know Mr. Mathi sir has already worked in Orissa on similar lines and provided much more, actually. Their scheme to Jaga Mission is amazing. They have ensured tenural status to the slum dwellers. That is a way forward. Maybe their state could do it because of the will. Are other states ready for it? Why are we not contemplating of giving cleaner environment to our residents who contribute to the GDP And we are not even capturing those numbers because it's all informal, right? They are contributing to our GDP. We have to keep them in our fold. We need them as much as they need us, but we need them more, I would say, because we need our services to be moving. Having them be productive citizens is very, very important. So how can we achieve it? That's one example I gave is probably a way to provide for securities. They will invest in their house. Just assure them that, look, nobody is going to evict you. You'll be here. They will invest in their own. We cannot provide probably affordable housing to all our citizens who require housing. That's not our country is not moving towards it. What is the best possible way? Where you are, maybe provide for them. Water sanitation is important. Once that is taken care of, people will invest in their own other things. So what we're discussing currently, we're working with four levels of the government. We're also working an ULM in New Delhi with the livelihoods mission. We're working with the state government in Telangana and Orissa big time. And we're working also with the communities and cities in Orissa and other parts of the country, about 20 of them. These cities, we've learned that unless the community is a partner, which many states now are looking at, self-help groups is a way forward. We organize them, we provide for them, and we've seen in the COVID times what response they've given. Making of masks, making of sanitizers, making of even giving little help, cash help from one household to another through the Sakhi banking loops, has been possible. So we have to strengthen the mechanisms. And what we are suggesting is, let's talk about city-wide and decentralized city facilitation centers. What can it do? It can enroll urban poor. It can enroll migrants, because people who come to city are looking for jobs. They need skilling. They need to find where the jobs are. The city facilitation centers, which are also embedded in some other way, named as city livelihood centers in many of the, in the NULM guidelines, the livelihoods mission guidelines, if we can strengthen that, would that be a way forward? We'll have to enumerate people who are coming. It would be probably supported by the self-help groups. The urban poor communities can take charge of it. We'll require NGOs to skill them, to counsel them, build their capacities, and provide legal aid if they require, see that they are placed in appropriate locations. So as I started talking, we have acts which give that support. The unorganized Workers Social Security Act of 2002 provides us possibility that we work with local governments, give them the power to create such maybe live facilitation centers, get the workers when they come back. It's unfortunately they've gone, but when they come back, they have a better life, better living conditions. Their jobs are secure, they get legal aid, and they are placed properly. We have to do it. It's high time. Thank you. I can take questions live or later.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Malvita. I think you have already taken us in the future scenario, what needs to be done. So now I think we all in a way, talked about in quite a futuristic terms, many of us, what should be done in those terms as well. And given that time is short with us, what I would do now is that I will take some of the questions and we'll also ask while you respond to some of those questions, maybe, if there are, in terms of new normal and how whatever has been done, whether it does us self-help groups or in certain policies, how do we sustain beyond COVID? Because now what has happened is that a large number of people, that energy has come together. How do we take it forward as well these whole learnings and work which has been done during this phase as well. So now I would want Mr. Mathi Vathanan, because there is a sir, two questions to you while you talk about it. One is about this question which has come to us from Sri Charan Seshadri has asked that question, and I think that question is on everyone's mind, that when the all the migrants workers are coming back to the city, and there would be water stress. So how do we work on that, and whether that stress also, when that stress is there, and we also at the same level, I would also like to link it with the revenue collection by the local people, how that will also impact, because it's a whole cycle. How do we work on that? And at the same time, there was a suggestion which came from Sandeep ji that public toilets should be made free for, I don't know, for the overall or for some months to come for the poor people. I think if you have some thoughts on that area as well, yes, please.
Yeah, I would be happy to answer these things. Very interesting questions. One is the migrant. Let us take the migrant issue. Migrant issue, currently Odisha is facing that large scale influx of migrants, especially from Surat, Maharashtra, Kerala. So in fact, I am the COVID observer for Ganjam district, which has the highest number of migrants, especially in Surat. So Ganjam district, one district alone has about 4 lakh migrants in Surat city alone, leave alone the other places, other states. So I was camping in the district. I was organizing the arrival of the trains, mobilizing them, and then taking care of them. So I was in the field in the migrant management. So very meaningful insights in that experience. Number one is that we also have the moment we realized that there will be migrants coming back to the state. The state has opened up a portal, developed a portal, and then enabled the migrants to register beforehand, so that the state knows to which districts the migrants will be coming, how many migrants are there, what will be the load, how do we organize the quarantine facilities, reception, all those things. So it's a part of our preparatory strategy. We did it. And then when we analyzed the data, we realized that 90% of the migrants are from the rural areas. Only 10% are from the urban areas. Rather, it's an insight to find out that urbanization is an antidote to migration. If you can invest in your cities, if you can develop your cities, if you can enlarge your cities, if you can provide opportunities in your cities, make life livable in the cities, the migration will reduce. Drastically, it will reduce. That is what we see in Odisha. Even within the urban migrants, again, 90% of the migrants are from the smaller towns. Very few are from Bhuneshwar, Cuttack, Berhampur, Sambalpur, very, very few, negligible. I would say that nothing. They are not migrants, actually. So you have students, you have professionals from these cities migrating to other cities, but laborers, they don't go from these cities because they get employment opportunities. They get some kind of economic activities to, involve. So cities provide life for them. So we realize that this urban area is one area where we need to invest if you have to invest in the future. So if you have to address the migration issue, you have to invest in cities. You have to make cities livable. The more in that, again, the informal settlements, the slums, if you invest in those places, if you are investing in the people, in our people, then you will not have all these problems. So it was very interesting. And then the impact of the migrants on the water supply system, I would say that, as I said, that urban areas would not be affected because the load is not very high. 90% goes to the rural areas, and the rural areas is such a vast 30 districts and, 6,000 panchayats, 60,000, more than 60,000 villages. So they get spreaded, dispersed in the villages. And then, the rural water supply, wherever we have the pipe water supply, the pipe water supply designs are, you know, designed for higher capacity, much higher capacity than the existing population. It can very well take, and if need be, they can always put up additional hand pump tubules to meet the requirements in the rural areas. In urban areas, it won't cause any problem. The second thing which you are talking about is, if you can, I'm forgetting the other issue which you want me to answer.
So, no, thanks. I just wanted to check, this suggestion came on, you know, they are very poor people and they use public toilets.
Yes. It has nothing to do with COVID. Even before COVID, our stance has been that public toilets should be made free of cost. Rather, we should incentivize people to use the public toilet. It should not be other way. You should not charge them. Otherwise, they will go and open defecate. They will spoil the environment. They will contaminate the groundwater. So rather, you should incentivize for every use. You use that public toilet and take 5 rupees. That should be the approach. So we should promote it. Otherwise, how do you achieve open defecation free status?
Okay, thanks. Thank you.
And the cities should invest on sanitation, should invest on these things. So that has been our stance and we are doing it. So in fact, we have a tie-up with Sulab International to design, construct, operate and maintain for 20 years in the state. So there also, the whatever is the, you know, gap, the municipality pays it. So we fix very, very nominal. And I've been promoting that we should not charge anything. Rather, our approach should be to encourage people to use public toilet more and more.
Thank you. Thank you. Very useful. I think it's very interesting to come from a policy person in terms of, you know, the, when we talk about overall O&M of public toilets and, you know, whether it should be made free or not. So I think we have very less time left, only 15 minutes to go. But I will just utilize this time to, you know, some of the critical questions which has come. One for Manvita. Manvita, one of the question is about in terms of, sorry, just a minute, give me a second. I'm so sorry. So there was a question for Manvita, which I could see.
Vanita, sorry, I was trying to respond to the question by, I think it was Sanjay Singh who asked the question
I can't see it. It's okay, so the same question.
I'm so sorry. Okay. Yeah, Sanjay, I'm so sorry. But I've got the question. It was about the experience of Gujarat about delinking what they
and,
did.
And very, very quickly, Manvita, please. Very quickly.
Just. Yeah, sure. I know. So this was a slum networking program, and in 96, the decision was taken that let's delink the provision of, the water and sanitation was given only if you own a house or a land or a property. So local government took a decision that let's delink it, even if you're squatting, even if you're encroached land or your land title is not clear, but you are entitled to get water and sanitation. That was a landmark decision that the local government took, and that led to development of this. However, this did not get scaled up over Gujarat. This was because Ahmedabad Municipal Corporation, the NGO at that point of time, supported by CSR of Arvind Mills, and the community, which was collectivized by NGO Seva and Saath, who came together and said, look, it's three of us will have to kind of come together and work it. So in a partnership model, 2,000 rupees, 2,000 and 2,000, one third partnership was taken and it was delivered. So this is one very important best practice. Maybe I can elaborate on some other forums, or I can send you the note if you send me an email. But this needs to be replicated all over the country. And because Jaga Mission is unique to you, to Orissa, I don't know whether that appetite would be there for other states, but at least this is the easiest thing we can immediately begin with. Thank you. There was one more question,
We are falling short of time. Yeah. You can just type that question in the chat box, right?
Okay.
So I, you know, before we close it in next 10 minutes, I would like to, you know, there are two things. One is about the sanitation workers issue which has come, and it would be good if Akhila, you can, you know, on the whole, you know, plight of sanitation workers during COVID, after COVID, you know, if you have some suggestion, you can throw some light on that issue. The other issue which is coming is about, again, you know, other two issues are about the land tenure. And, you know, the way, unlike Odisha, I think that question also has come in the chat box. Unlike Odisha, many states don't give that kind of security. And then people don't invest into wash services. So that is another issue. So if you have any thought for those two, and just to make use of this time. And to Sanjay ji, the other question is that, you know, we are talking about making public toilets free, but at the same time, you know, we are also hearing about the whole, during COVID situation, the kind of threat because of risk because of the public toilets. And then, you know, one of the suggestion could be to make individual toilets, but which may not be possible in a very short run. So what could be the, you know, if the people have been thinking about SOP, especially for public toilets, how to go about it in congested areas. So yeah, over to you, Akhila, and then we will hear from.
And answer the second question first, Anita, on this business of tenure. You know, in the metros, in the big cities, it's going to pose a problem. So one at one level is what you call reading down a process. In the last 4 years, just by saying, the Delhi government just saying, you know, we will not evict anybody except under in-situ rehabilitation. If you're relocated, you'll be relocated nearby. There'll be no inconvenience to you. Just making even a statement like that suddenly encouraged people in the slum to improve their habitat. Not about the minute you make anything big and you know you think that everything will happen, it doesn't happen because it's a challenging situation in big cities. But to read down the law, guide them through the process, to entrust them, invest in their leadership, critical. On the sanitation worker issue, very, very critical issue, you know, not only about giving them the protective gear, safety gear, even our health workers are now struggling to get all of that. We have enough accounts about how they are also being exposed to the virus because of poor protection. So that is one level of, you know, whatever, action that we need to take. More importantly, it's a way, you know, the contracting is done of the sanitation workers. The labor laws that are not applied, kind of regulations that are not working, all of that needs to be tightened up. In Karnataka, we actually have a scheme where they get a midday meal because they come to work around 6 in the morning, 5:30 in the morning, so they get actually a meal. So to plan the entire social entitlements for them, like, you know, to have special OPDs, to have proper, you know, health camps, all of that needs to be done. They have occupational health, you know, challenges. And, you know, forging a close link with community structures, frontline workers, all of that is also very critical. And ensuring their dignity and ensuring their care is the least one can do. Right now, the situation is quite hostile and unfavorable to them. Not, you know, they're not able to get out of the clutches of all kinds of, you know, exploitation and poor working conditions and the kind of subcontracting that is going on.
Yes, thanks. I think that's an issue which we need to. Mr. Mathivathanan wants to say something, but
this is about the public toilets.
Okay. So please go ahead, and after that we will also take this question with Mr. Sandeep also on the public toilet. Please go ahead, sir.
Okay, public toilet. See, public toilet, in view of the COVID, the question is whether our focus should be on individual toilets. So public toilets are toilets which are located in the high footfall areas where floating population is there. So that cannot be avoided. So it's not an alternative for the individual household toilet. He's talking about community toilet, where instead of individual toilets, because of lack of land or space available for constructing individual toilet, people opt for community toilet. So there, it's not out of choice, it is out of compulsion. You don't have space, you don't have land, there's no way you can construct a toilet, individual household toilet, so you are going for a community toilet. Now the solution is that how do you improve, enhance the quality of maintenance, whether it is public toilet or community toilet. So we have to take the maintenance to a different level. So it's just because COVID threat is there, you cannot close the public toilet or community toilet. You can't wish away that. You have to live with the public toilet. The answer lies in how you enhance the level of maintenance. Why only the airport toilets and the five-star toilets will have that kind of standards, hygiene? Why not a public toilet? That question. Is it that urban local bodies cannot provide that kind of maintenance standards, hygiene standards? Or why is that mindset? It's a question of mindset. What do you want to deliver? What kind of service you want to provide to the public? It depends upon that. So in Odisha, we have taken a stance recently that every public toilet, community toilet, should have a water jetting machine. It costs not more than 7,000 rupees. It doesn't cost more than 7,000 rupees. In fact, majority of our public toilets have a water jetting machine. High pressure water jets, if it is provided in each public toilet, that itself will take care of the cleaning, you know, to a large extent. So with the personal protective equipments to the sanitation workers, if cleanliness, the consumables, all those things, and the remuneration paid to the sanitation workers, if they are taken care of, then you can maintain service level benchmark in the public toilets. It depends upon how much you want to invest in the public toilet and cleanliness. So that's what I want to say.
No, very good. Thanks. Very good insight. So we have just 4 minutes to, you know, to go, but I would want Sandeep further to, you know, on this whole issue, because you're working in slums and on the public and the community toilets, especially on the community toilets, if you have any, you know, further suggestions in terms of SOP or, you know, other suggestions in terms of hygiene, how to go about it.
जहाँ तक अभी मैं बात कर रहा था अभी साथी कि वो कम्युनिटी टॉयलेट के लिए कि मैं जो बातचीत कर रहा था जहाँ पे लोगों ने कर्ज लिया है या उस तरह से वो कम्युनिटी टॉयलेट के संदर्भ में था. पब्लिक टॉयलेट तो मोस्टली लॉकडाउन के दौरान बंद ही थे यूपी में या जो जहाँ खुले भी थे वहाँ पे जो पुलिस एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन और उनके द्वारा इस्तेमाल हो रहे थे क्योंकि पब्लिक पे हाईवे पे है नहीं इस तरीके के टॉयलेट. अगर हम यमुना एक्सप्रेस वे देखें बाकी जो एक्सप्रेस वे देखें तो करीब 200-300 किलोमीटर की दूरी पे टॉयलेट्स हैं. जो लोग अगर गुजरे होंगे दिल्ली टू लखनऊ या बाकी जगहों पे तो वो देख सकते हैं. मेरा एक सुझाव था जो मैं वाटर अलाउंसेस के संदर्भ में भी बात कर रहा था कि कम्युनिटी टॉयलेट्स को फॉर द टाइम बिंग फ्री कर देना चाहिए और उसके सारे एक्सपेंडिचर्स को नगर लोकल बॉडीज को बियर करना चाहिए. और दूसरा हम लखनऊ के संदर्भ में या उत्तर प्रदेश के संदर्भ में बात करें तो पैरामीटर्स तय हैं कम्युनिटी टॉयलेट्स के अंदर मगर वो फॉलो नहीं होते हैं क्योंकि मेंटेनेंस बहुत पुअर है. तो उसके लिए कोई सिस्टम डेवलप होने चाहिए क्योंकि एक और दिक्कत है ज्यादातर जगहों पे हमने टॉयलेट सैनिटेशन सर्विसेज को प्राइवेट किया है चाहे वो सुलभ को दे रहे हों या किसी को भी दे रहे हों. तो जो बहुत सारा जो स्टडीज मौजूद है या हम देखते हैं जमीनी स्तर पे कि सुलभ को देने से हम लोग ये मान लेते हैं कि सुलभ ने बहुत अच्छे से मेंटेन कर रहे हैं बट उनकी जो कंडीशंस है वहाँ पे पानी की जो एक्सेस है दरवाजे जो जिस तरीके से वो हैं वो भी एक दिक्कत है. एक और चीज मैं खास करके इस ओर ध्यान इंगित कराना चाहूंगा क्योंकि डिजाइन ऑफ द कम्युनिटी टॉयलेट वो हमको बहुत ध्यान रखने की जरूरत है क्योंकि ज्यादातर जगह पे क्या होता है कि महिलाएं टॉयलेट का इस्तेमाल उतने अच्छे से नहीं करती हैं क्योंकि जो कम्युनिटी टॉयलेट के डिजाइन है उसमें एंट्री एक तरफ से है एक ही तरीके से बहुत बार जाने के लिए होती है जहाँ पे दोनों लोगों के लिए जहाँ सेपरेट महिलाओं के लिए वहाँ कोई दिक्कत नहीं है. तो उस पर बहुत काम करने की आने वाले दिनों में जरूरत है क्योंकि वो ठीक से बन पाए डिजाइन ना कम्युनिटी टॉयलेट. दूसरा एक चीज और कि हम अगर देखें तो ये भी बहुत इंक्लूसिव नहीं है क्योंकि पुरुष लोग खास करके जब टॉयलेट इस्तेमाल करते हैं तो उनमें कुछ सेवाओं के लिए वो फ्री है उनके लिए बट वीमेंस के लिए कोई सेवा फ्री नहीं है वहाँ पे. मतलब अगर हम उसे देखें तो टॉयलेट्स के लिए जब वो जाती हैं या जाते हैं तो उसके बारे में भी हमको एक स्टैंडर्ड कम से कम देखने की जरूरत है कि करें. और ड्यूरिंग लॉकडाउन ही नहीं बल्कि ये तरीके का कम्युनिटी के ऊपर हेल्थ कम्युनिटी के हेल्थ एक्सपेंडिचर्स को बचाना भी है तो और शहर की सफाई पे जो खर्च हो रहे हैं उसको बचाना है, तो मुझे लगता है कि एसओपी जो कम्युनिटी टॉयलेट्स को लेके बने या पब्लिक टॉयलेट्स को लेके बने वो लोगों को प्रमोट करने के लिए हो कि लोग ज्यादा से ज्यादा उसका इस्तेमाल कर पाए, तो उनको फ्री कर देना चाहिए और उस एक्सपेंडिचर्स को लोकल बॉडीज को यूज करना चाहिए।
थैंक्स संदीप। So, thanks a lot to all our panelists. Unfortunately, we could not get, you know, because Bajan Wilson has been quite busy, we could not get him. And I don't think any of us can fill his place to talk about sanitation work and especially on manual scavengers. So hopefully next time. But I think I think these discussions were very, very insightful, very useful. And I hope people who have been hearing would also have, it must have been come as very interesting for them as well. And as you know, there is a lot of work to be done and to learn from, you know, what is happening in each other's state. And I think that's why these platforms are very important. You know, the way we heard from Odisha, what is happening, or some of the ideas which are coming from other civil society members and think tanks. So with this, I will close this session, and thanks a lot to all the people, panelists, as well as the Nudge team who has been supporting this, as well as the WaterAid team. So together, thanks to all.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Namaste.